Morning, good morning. Hope you all had a good weekend. So, my cordless wireless microphone has given up. So, these next few lectures are probably going to be a little bit difficult to follow on YouTube. So make sure you pay attention here until I figure out how to get another microphone. Okay? Any questions from last lecture? Okay, so last time we did our vector calculus review. We went through divergence and gradients and discussed their intuitive meaning. I forgot to talk to you about the, I think I told you I want to talk to you about the components of the cross product or the vector product, but I didn't do that. So I'm going to do that today, and that will be the segue to do to discuss curl, which would be a good segue. So we're going to go back to vector product. So we said we defined two types of products for vector: the dot product, which was the scalar product that resulted in a scalar quantity, which is just a value. The vector product is defined as A times B using this symbol times, and we said that's a vector that points either out of the plane or into the plane based on your right-hand rule. On the right-hand rule, so if A and B are like this, you know, you just, if A cross B, you start from A, go to B, so that's gonna be a vector pointing out of the board. If you're doing B cross A, that you start from B, go to A, use the right-hand rule, and it's a vector pointing into the board. So we talked about that, but what I didn't talk about is actually the magnitude of this vector. So that's the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of the angle. So the magnitude is the sine of the angle between the two vectors. So with the dot product, we were talking about the cosine. So A times B times the cosine, the magnitude of the dot product, which is a scalar. So, but in this case, because this is a vector, you have to take a magnitude, and that magnitude is AB sine theta. And the way you do, so this is a vector we said, we call it C, A cross B. And in Cartesian coordinates, and in orthogonal coordinates, in I, J, K, I don't know if you're familiar with this rule, yeah, pretty easy. So A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3. And that gives you the three components. So you start with I, you draw kind of these two vertical lines. So that gives you, you take the discriminant of this little matrix here, A2, B3 minus A3, B2, A3, B2. Those are the components of the vector in the direction I. And then in the direction J, you put a minus sign, and then you do the same thing. You draw a line, vertical line on J, and then horizontal line here. You take the discriminant of this matrix, A1, B3, minus A3, B1, J, plus the K component. You also draw a vertical line, horizontal line, and take the discriminant of this matrix, A1, B2, minus A2, B1, K. So this gives you the components of the vector, that is the cross product of vectors A and B, and C points either into or out of the plane. Okay, any questions? Okay, now on to the vector calculus equivalent of the cross product. So I told you that I like to treat the nabla operator, that del operator, the differential operator, as a vector. So I call it, although strictly speaking, that's not really true, but it kind of helps you simplify things, helps you think of an operator as just any other vector with three components. So last time we took nabla, and in for Cartesian coordinates, we said nabla is equal to d dx, d dy, d dz, right? And we took the dot product of nabla with a vector u that gives you the divergence of u, and we discussed how that is equal to the net outflow of volume at an infinitesimal point, and we did some examples on that. Today we're going to talk about, so that's the equivalent, so nabla dot u is the equivalent of the scalar product of two vectors. Now, what's the equivalent of the vector product between for two vectors, between nabla and another vector, is called the cross product. And you know, you've seen that, correct? Cross product, it's simply the, so actually the curve, not the cross product, sorry. It is the cross product of nabla and a vector, so curve. It's simply the cross product of nabla and some vector u. And I keep using u to reinforce that this is a velocity field, also written as curl u. Okay, so I'm going to interchange notation in homework, and in problems you're going to see exchange of notation. So what is curl? What's curl? And someone, you've seen the curl of a vector, right? So what is your intuitive, beyond the mechanistic, you know, formula? I mean, I can give you the formula, same thing, I to k, and d dx, d dy, d dz, and u1, u2, u3, and you do the whole thing, you get a vector, obviously. Okay. But beyond this, what is the meaning of curve?
It's like the rotational analog of the vector field.
The rotational analog of the vector field. That's you're onto it. So there are if a formal definition of the curl is, I'm just gonna write the definition, and we're gonna discuss its meaning. Okay, is curl of curve u, so let's call that this way, as curl u, we agree that this is a vector, okay? So I'm going to take this vector, so now assume there is some vector field, all sorts of directions, right? That's our vector field u. So if you draw a closed line around some point p, and take the integral of or the line integral of u dot dr. So whatever u dotted with dr, this is an area element, and it changes on different locations of the curve. So you essentially take u dotted with dr and just add all of these up along the curve. That gives you this line integral. What is that from your physics?
Pardon me?
No.
No.
No. Work. What is the work done by a force as it's moving on a path? It's the dot product of the force with the path, right? Along the path. And you take the integral, that gives you the work. It's just the work done, okay? Now, if we divide this by this area, okay, normalize by this area, this A, and you shrink this to point B, the limit as area goes to zero, that actually gives you the curve. That's the definition. Or specifically the curl dotted with the unit normal of the area. So in this case, it's a vector pointing out. Okay, so that's one description, is that the curl kind of measures the work done by a vector u along a closed path as you traverse it counterclockwise, normalized by the area A. But that's also equal to the circulation of u. What is the circulation? It's like how much you spin around a point. Okay, that's the definition from this integral. Another definition, and we're not gonna do the derivation on this, another definition is that the curve is equal to twice the rotation vector. I'm gonna use the C here. Twice the angular rotation vector. Okay, so let's think about it this way, and now we're gonna switch to some fluid dynamics. If you have flow in a pipe, okay, loosely from your understanding of fluids, the velocity profile in this pipe, the velocity near the boundary is gonna be zero, correct? Slightly closer to the boundary, it's not gonna be zero. Far away from the boundary, it starts becoming kind of a bit larger, and then we start shrinking back all the way, etc., to zero. So you get this nice, what we call the laminar flow in a pipe, right? You get this nice roll. Okay. So now I want you to imagine with me, and I wish we had like a channel, or next time you go to the museum or the aquarium where they have these nice little channels. Do the following. Take two pieces of, if you eat a popsicle, and just take the piece of wood and kind of cut it in half, make a cross, okay? And put a cross in here, like a little thing. So what's gonna happen to that thing if you get it close to the boundary? Yeah, it's gonna start rotating, right? Why? Because the velocity of this point a bit larger than the velocity of that point, so the flow is gonna push this guy in this direction, right? And it's gonna keep on spinning. Okay, so it's a great illustration of what we call the boundary layer. If you get it closer to the center, probably not gonna see too much rotation, it's just gonna keep on moving, okay? The rate at which this is spinning, that's an angular velocity, okay? The rate at which this is spinning is actually the curve. So in terms of fluids, the curl measures the rate of rotation of a fluid element. We're gonna discuss fluid elements later, but think of this little cross as that's what's happening actually to chunks of fluid molecules. If you take a collection of fluid molecules and put them in this flow, and you track them, what's gonna happen? They're gonna shear and they're gonna start rotating and mixing with each other, okay? Now, Let's show you also loosely how this is related to the rate of angular rotation. So you know what angular rotation is, okay? So if you have something, remind you of angular rotation, okay? So let's say you have a little ball over here spinning, or you have a little ball on a rope and you kind of start spinning it, right? You can measure the angular rotation, and that the units of angular rotation are radians per second. Now, radian is a dimensionless quantity. It's an angle. Okay? So let's say you put two balls, and you spin them. Are they going to have the same angular rotation? Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. Okay? Because it's an angle per second. How much angle are you sweeping per second? But are they gonna have the same velocity? No. Why? The radius multiplied by the angular velocity. So r omega, or r times angular velocity, I'm not using omega because I wanna reserve it to vorticity, angular rotation gives you tangential velocity, okay, in meters per second, okay? What are the units of this? So one thing you should always do to even try to understand the meaning of something is just write down the units. So what are the units of this? Gradient is 1/m, correct? Because you have d by dx and d by dy. That's 1/length. Well, we can put it 1/length. Let's just keep it 1/m times meter per second. That's equal 1/s. That's actually an angular rotation. So this is another check that the curl of a velocity field or a vector field is a measure of the angular rotation. Technically, it's equal to twice the angular rotation of a fluid element, okay? So loosely speaking, what is the curl of a velocity field? It measures how much rotation you have at a point. So if you dump a fluid element at a point, or you put some ink at a point, and you have very high curl, that's going to spin really fast versus somewhere where you don't have a lot of curl. Or more intuitively is when you have a large gradient in velocity. So if you have a flow that, you know, let's say at the entrance of the pipe, your flow is nearly uniform, you're not going to have much rotation, right? Because you don't have a gradient between the velocity to shear and rotate the fluid element. But as you go further downstream, you're going to have more rotation. Okay. Now we call this the vorticity. I'm going to reserve the symbol omega, although some people interchange, they reserve the symbol C for the vorticity and omega for the angular rotation. But you're going to be dealing with this. Okay. Any questions?
What are we going to use as a symbol for the angular rotation?
We're not going to be using angular rotation. We're going to use, if we need to use it, we'll use it. You can use whatever symbol you want.
Do you have angular velocity?
Angular rotation. Angular. Yeah, angular, so per second. So radians per second. Radians per second. Angular, yeah, it's angular velocity. The other one's tangential velocity, as we are. Okay. Just a couple of things. Okay. Now, two definitions before we go through and start doing some real fluids is what happens when curl U is zero? We call this flow your rotation. When there's no vorticity in a flow, we call this irrotational. Once we derive the governing equations, you're going to see that when you set this equal to zero, it simplifies a ton of things. So historically, the development has been, they derive the equations and they're like, oh, what if this term is zero? It simplifies things a lot, and then we can find analytical solutions and simplify a lot of things. And then, you know, came up the idea of irrotational flow. That simplifies things quite a bit. Okay, so keep that in mind. It's going to be asked about it in your homework. Okay, the other thing going to divergence, when you have div u equals zero, what did we call that? Incompressible flow, because div u is the net outflow of fluid volume, okay? Or the net dilatation of a fluid volume, all right? When you cannot compress or expand a fluid volume, then it's incompressible, okay? The volume remains the same. The shape changes, but the volume remains the same, okay? That's incompressible flow. And you're going to have a couple of questions on these in the homework. Okay. So keep that in mind. Okay. Great. We are done. Any questions? Okay. So let me finish off. Yes.
What happens when curl is positive or curl is negative?
It's just rotation in different directions. We'll see that there are some theorems for inviscid flows, for example, that you have to conserve vorticity. You know, if there's a region that is positive, it is to be counterbalanced by a region that's negative. Okay, so, but it just essentially tells you that over here an element is going to rotate this way, over here is going to rotate that way. So positive, negative. Okay. Finally, we'll finish off with three integral theorems, and I'll go over those real quick. And we'll start with we need to get those out of the way. I'm trying to just get enough math out of the way. I don't want to do any math hazing, because these will be relevant for the next few lectures. And then we're going to return and do a little bit more math on tensors, because those are going to be relevant to the Navier-Stokes to simplify how we write the equations. But I'm not doing this for the sake, I picked the the minimum set of math that is needed, okay, to do our work. But the reality is you have to be very well versed in vector and tensor calculus if you want to do fluids, if you want to do really high level fluids. The great integral theorems for vector calculus will start with the gradient theorem. Okay. And that tells you that on a volume V, take a little volume. I will tell you why we are doing this. This is going to be really important for us in the future. If you take a volume V, and notice I use this symbol for V, political reason, so we distinguish it from velocity. This says that the triple integral over the volume, sometimes I may write integral over V to simplify, but you should know that this is a triple integral. Triple integral over the volume of the gradient of a scalar, phi dV, is equal to the surface integral over the closed surface. So if this is S, okay, and this is an area ds, that's n ds, okay? So that's equal to phi n ds. So what this is saying is that the volume integral of the gradient of a scalar is equal to the surface integral of that scalar, okay, times the unit surface area of the surface. Now, why is this going to be really important to us? Because we're going to derive the governing equations in two ways. We're going to derive them using an integral formulation, which is in the opinion of many mathematicians is the more rigorous way, because you don't have to worry about discontinuities, etc. You just take an integral over a certain volume and you just derive the equations. Now, and we're also going to use a differential formulation to derive the equations, but there's a third way to go directly from a volume integral to a differential form if we write all the integrals in the same type. So when we derive the momentum equations, you're going to have surface in integral form. We're going to have surface and volume forces. So we need to convert everything into either volume integrals or surface integrals. And we're going to say, oh, all of these are equal. So therefore, the integrands must be equal. And that's how you get the differential form in one shot. Okay. So it's really important to know how we can go from a surface to a volume integral. This is really going to be for the pressure. When we do the integral form of the momentum equation, or the Navier-Stokes equation, we're going to have this integral, a surface integral of the pressure force. Okay, so that's the pressure force. Then we will need to convert that into a volume integral, and that's how you get the gradient of the pressure. Okay. Two more integrals. The Gaussian theorem, or Gauss-Ostrogradsky's theorem, or divergence theorem. So divergence theorem, Gauss-Ostrogradsky. Okay, this one tells you, and this is related to the dilatation we learned last time. From says that the net outflow of a vector field out of a surface, so if you have some vector u and with a surface with a unit normal n, this integral measures the net outflow in this volume, that's equal to the volume integral of div u d. Okay? So that relates to what we discussed last time. Okay? You can check the units this is meters per second times meter squared. This one is 1 over meter times meters per second times meters cubed. So that gives you meters cubed per second.
That's global volume.
Okay? And finally, Stokes' theorem. Not sure we're going to use this a lot, but I wanted it to be in your notes. Stokes' theorem. That was a lot more relevant in the historical development of inviscid and irrotational flow, which was very relevant to the early development of Fermi aerodynamics. And it says that, I'm just going to write it first, the line integral over a closed curve traversed clockwise, u dot dc is equal. This is actually the definition we just discussed earlier for the curve. Curl u dot n ds. So on a closed curve traversed clockwise, curve C, and this is element dc, the integral of u dot, or the work done by u along this curve, is equal to the integral of the curl dotted by the unit normal on this surface. So if you draw a three-dimensional surface like this, okay? And that's Stokes' theorem. Okay. One note on cylindrical coordinates or other coordinates. We're not going to do spherical. It gets a bit more tedious with the algebra. So the same ideas apply for cylindrical coordinates in terms of vectors. It's just the unit vectors are different, the basis vectors and cylindrical coordinates are different, and specifically, the radial and tangential unit vectors, they change direction depending on where you are. So that's a challenge with cylindrical coordinates. Let me see if I can draw it in a nice way. I'm gonna take a reference, the x, y, z, and the idea of cylindrical coordinates is that you are located on a cylinder. See my drawing skills. Should have practiced this at home first. Okay. So the idea of cylindrical coordinates is that you change in elevation z, okay? You change in elevation z. And then at any elevation z, that's going to give you your z component. That's going to give you the z component. Then you draw a vector in the radial direction. That gives you dr. And then you have a vector in the theta direction. So your cylindrical coordinates basis vectors are er, e theta, and ez. And any vector in cylindrical coordinates is written as ar, a theta, az. Dot product remains the same. A dot B is AR BR plus A theta B theta plus AZ BZ. And same thing for also the cross product. Similar to Cartesian coordinates, you just do, you know, ER E theta EZ. And then you do AR, A theta, AZ, BR, theta, AZ. When it gets interesting is for grad, div, and curl, the gradient of phi in cylindrical coordinates is equal to d phi by dr, and then 1 over r d phi by d theta, and d phi by dz. And check the units, you know, this is dimensions phi over length, and this is dimensions phi over length, because that theta is dimensionless, and this is dimensions phi over length. And you get this r floating around because of the arc length, r times theta, so you're going to get that everywhere. The divergence is a little bit tricky. 1 over r dr ur by dr, forget this, plus 1 over r du theta by d theta plus duz by dz. Okay. Finally, curl. We can spend the day deriving these. Just trust me on this. And the curl. So be careful. This is not going to be the same as the cross product. Dr theta dz. And again, d by dr, d by d theta, d by dz. And over here, don't forget, you're going to have an r u theta over here. Don't forget this guy. Okay, and that gives you three components in the r, theta, and z direction. And you can convert between cylindrical and Cartesian. Actually, I have thought of a better way of drawing this so that it's clear. Do is and EZ is the one that points in the Z direction. Okay? So as you move at any point in the XYZ space, your ER and E theta are going to change. Okay? So that's the challenge with cylindrical coordinates. As you differentiate things, you're going to get components from the other vectors. Okay? There. We're done with vector calculus. I'll give you a minute to catch up. This would be found in any standard textbook or on Wikipedia. So transforming between the unit vectors, so Ex is cosine theta Er minus sine theta E theta, and Ui is sine theta Er plus cosine theta e theta, and ez is equal to ez, and er is cosine theta ex plus sine theta ey, e theta is minus sine theta ex plus cosine theta ey, and ez is ez. This will help you when you're transforming from one vector to another. So, you know, you get it, sometimes it's easier to get the solution in spherical coordinates, and then you want to plot it, and you need x, y components, so you need to transform between the two, okay? All right, we're done with this short math phasing. I'm sure for some of you this has been a little bit boring, but for some it was useful to do a review. We're done with this. Now we're going to get started on actually deriving some equations for fluid mechanics. So I'm going to ask you this. How do you suggest you as an engineer, okay, you're given the task to study this, we discovered this new material from outer space that we call a fluid. Okay, so I bring this material with me. come here bearing gifts, and it's a fluid. As an engineer, how do you suggest we study this fluid? Let's assume that we know that this fluid obeys the same physical laws here on Earth and out in the universe. Okay? Same physical laws apply. So how would you suggest we develop a mathematical theory for said fluid, said alien fluid? What do we do? So what do you, yeah?
I'd say like take Newton's laws of motion.
Yes, uh-huh, okay, Newton's law, so let's write that. Taking suggestions or ideas to study fluid.
As to study alien. Oh, outer space. No, that's what I'm trying to avoid. Okay, so outer space fluid. Okay? Right. So we said we have an idea, Newton's law.
We said that this fluid satisfies the same laws of physics. So what other laws, what other great law you can think of?
Thermodynamics.
Thermodynamics,
okay.
Yep, thermodynamics. First, second, etc. Thermodynamics. What else?
Conservation.
And
composition
analysis, what it's made of. Okay. Okay. But is that gonna help us in the mathematical theory? That's just gonna tell us what it's made of, right?
Physical properties.
Yeah, so that's physical property, that's not really. So when we say a mathematical theory, what you wanna do, you wanna relate rates of change of different quantities, energy, heat, mass, momentum, right? So you said conservation. So now, I want you each to back your claims. What is Newton's law? Trust me, this will be useful, okay?
His law of viscosity, or which law are you?
Newton's second law, okay?
Oh.
So, yeah.
I don't remember which one's which, but it has to obey, like, general mechanics.
Yeah, so like Newton's second law is
acceleration.
Yes, so is that, you know, if an object is in motion, the only way you can change its direction is by imposing a force. So that changes acceleration. First law is an object in motion will remain in motion unless acted upon by a force. Okay? So Newton's first law says, says that mass, right, times acceleration, or m du by dt is equal to summation of forces. Okay, so we bring this fluid to Earth. We know that there's gonna be a force of gravity, okay, F gravity plus pressure. So I'm gonna introduce some terms that you may be familiar with. So we're gonna have a pressure force plus something that we call viscosity. But you nailed it here. You're like, yeah, this is, you know, this fluid should obey the same laws of classical mechanics that we understand, right? That's actually your first equation for a fluid. We're gonna show that this is just rho g, this is grad p, and this is some stress tensor. Okay, we'll dig deeper into the stress tensor. Okay, but we still have a problem, but I wanna go through the other laws. Who said thermodynamics? You said that. Okay. So what's the equation for?
That's like heat versus laws, conservation of energy.
Conservation of energy is you take a system, okay, you add heat minus work done by the system on the surroundings. So surroundings adding heat to the system minus work done by the system on the surroundings. That results in a change of internal energy. And that's written essentially by delta Q minus delta W is equal to change in internal energy. Now, we are interested in differential equations because differential equations, essentially they're measuring rates of change. And as you're no longer worried about absolute or specific values or nominal values of a quantity. All you worry about is the rates of changes of those quantities. So I want to convert this to a PDE, and that's actually fairly easy. It's simply dE by dt is equal to Q dot rate of heat addition minus rate of work done on the surrounding. Okay. So we're actually deriving the equations of fluid motion right here. Okay, conservation. Okay, so what are we gonna talk about conservation? I mean, you could say that this is conservation of energy, right? What else did we miss?
What's
mass? Mass conservation. So we can talk about mass. What does mass conservation say? Can mass cannot be created or destroyed. We have to account for everything. Whatever is coming in, whatever is being generated, whatever has been taken out has to balance. Okay? Mass and species, chemical species, etc. So you're combining atoms, different combinations, you're changing them, but they all should be conserved. Okay? Let's focus on mass. What is the law of conservation of mass? For non-relativistic, don't get me into relativistic mechanics and whatever that. Okay, this is just okay, so conservation of mass, what do we say? Before we get there. Pardon me?
The summation of the inlet is equal to the summation of the outlet.
But where does that apply? That applies to like a pipe flow. But what about the fluid itself? So if I take a fluid from here and move it over there, what happens to the mass?
Nothing.
So mass is constant. That's the conservation law. In other words, M, we use the symbol lowercase m, m is equal to constant. So how do I get a differential form from this?
Dm dt.
Dm dt, dm by dt is equal to zero. Look at you, you derive the equations of fluid mechanics. Okay?
In a not very useful form.
In a not very useful form, yes. Why? Why?
There's not much we can really do yet.
They're all like different variables.
Yeah, they're all like different variables. Different.
Well, there's mass. We can relate this to density, which is related to mass. We can this is a pressure, okay, which we have to measure or figure out how to solve for. And this can be related to the velocity. So no, we have all the variables. What is not so useful about these equations? At least, not practical. They are true, they are correct, okay? And at some point in the future, when we have very, very large supercomputers, we're gonna be able to just use these equations, okay? But what is so not useful about these? Okay. It's these derivatives, okay? These derivatives, all the laws of classical mechanics apply to a system. Apply to a collection of particles of a unique identity. Okay? What that means to fluids is that, okay, if I want to apply this to a fluid, I need to apply it to hundreds of millions of collections of molecules in that fluid. So I need to take this bucket of fluid and draw a line on molecule 1, 2, and 3, let's say, until we hit this continuum assumption. We collect, and that was 10 to the 7 molecules for air. We get 10 to the 7 molecules. We have to kind of capture them and follow them as they flow in the pipe. And then you could have hundreds of millions of those volumes. So there's no way we can practically track all of these systems of molecules. So let me reiterate, the laws of thermodynamics apply to a system an identifiable, of its unique identity. You can identify it, just like when you pick a solid body, it's moving through space, you say, oh yeah, I can track the body. But we have hundreds of millions of those. There is no way we can practically solve these equations for these hundreds of millions of molecules, even in a numerical simulation. It's really impossible, okay? But these equations, they hold true. Now the problem is not with this, the problem is these guys. Okay? So let me show you now another alternative, an alternative that allows us to convert these equations into something more tractable. We call this formulation the Lagrangian formulation, okay? Of fluid motion, if you want. Or the Lagrangian formulation is when you're tracking individual particles, when you're tracking individual systems of a unique identity. Okay, but this doesn't help us with fluids because we have hundreds of millions of molecules. Again, does this make sense? Does this resonate? You've probably in your research at some point, we actually had that happen to us in my colleague's research group. You know, we wanted to apply this new thermodynamic law to, not the new thermodynamic law, we wanted to apply a thermodynamic law to a system, and we're like, is this, the question was, is this a Lagrangian system or something else? So we had to recognize that this is actually a Lagrangian formulation. So we track individual items. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna write here at the bottom, sys, or system, okay? To say that this is for a specific system, all right? Now what's a better way? A better way is, again, I'm gonna take like a, you know, some jet, some system, whatever, and rather than tracking the individual particles, what if we can somehow assign we're tracking mass, which is related to density, okay? And we're tracking velocity over here. That's in the end what we're dealing with. And energy, could be enthalpy or temperature, okay? Something related to energy. So what if, rather than tracking the individual particles or system collection of fluids and saying, okay, over here, this fluid, this system has the following density and has the following velocity, and this fluid has, you know, U2 and rho2, and this one has U1 and rho1, and then this one moved over here, and now it has a different velocity, and then you bring it. Rather than doing all of this, what if we can instead say, okay, forget about this. Is there a way where I can step out, okay, and just look at the flow and pick points in the system in question, in the physical setup in question, and say every fluid particle or fluid element or collection of fluid elements, whatever you want to call it, that passes through this point is going to have velocity U1, and over here is going to have velocity U2, going to have velocity U3, and so on, regardless of the identity of the fluid particle. So let's say, you know, you're walking in and I tell you, you know, at that door, your speed is gonna be 1 meter per second. Or there's something, there's a conveyor belt. You're walking on a conveyor belt, for example, and the speed over there is 1 meter per second. Whoever you are, your speed is gonna be 1 meter per second at that point, okay? And that's what we call the Eulerian perspective or the lab reference frame. Okay, you're stepping out, you're looking at something, okay? And you're saying whatever fluid goes in, it doesn't matter where it came from, I don't care about the identity of the fluid, that fluid is gonna inherit the properties that I am observing at that point.
Yes. So is that like a control volume?
That's the control volume formulation. So what we're gonna do next is we're gonna figure out how we can convert from d by dt into something else, into an Eulerian frame. The power of this is that you no longer care about the fluid element. All you care about is x, y, z. And then you define your velocity and mass or density as a function of x, y, z. And then once you solve for those, it doesn't matter what fluid you put in, what identity is coming in, okay? So that's the trick. Now, we're gonna do this in two ways. We're gonna do this using an integral form, which is the Reynolds transport theorem. Has anyone heard of it? Yes. So does that make more sense to you today, the Reynolds transport theorem? Not yet. It's essentially a translation of from the Eulerian perspective to a Lagrangian perspective, okay? So we're gonna do an integral form, in which, rather than tracking a single or the smallest volume, we're gonna take a finite size collection of fluid particles, okay, that we can integrate over. We're gonna take a finite size collection of particles, So finite size collection, collection of fluid particles. And we're going to do a differential form. We're going to take the smallest, we're going to take essentially the Reynolds form and make it infinitesimal. They're going to be equivalent. We're going to derive this in a different way. Okay? And this is what you know as the material derivative. So, strictly speaking, to go from this to the Eulerian form, all you need is the material derivative. I'll give you a really nice example once we get to the material derivative, so that once and for all you're going to understand what that means. If you understand it, it's not going to matter. Material derivative. Okay? Any questions?
So would the Lagrangian formulation be like choosing a material body, and then this would be choosing a control volume?
Yes. Okay. Yes. That's what it is. So we're going to call this the material description, or a system description, a material point, or a material element, material, okay? Or substance, you've heard of this word substantial derivative. Substantial comes from the word substance, so you're following the substance. Rather than following the substance, we want the substance to follow the location, okay? We're gonna do this in two ways. We're gonna do the integral form because it's a little bit, you know, some people think it's a little bit more rigorous, okay? We're gonna cover all of these. But in the end, the results will be the same. So really, what we're missing here, this is going to be relatively easy because the material of the system is rho times the volume of that system. And we're going to convert this derivative into something related to velocities and densities. This guy, once we figure out the Reynolds transport or the material derivative, this guy is very easy to write in Eulerian form. Then for the remainder of the course, we're going to be dealing with the viscous forces. And this one, we'll see if we cover it. We're going to cover it in later classes. All right, any questions? Okay, you're going to have your first homework assignment today. It's going to be on Canvas, so make sure you check that. You will have 1 week, so it will be due Monday midnight, so Tuesday early morning. Okay? I'll release it with you.